Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to show you my Bitcoin powered garage heater. So with that, let's get started. But before showing you my garage heater, I just want to mention the sponsor of this episode, Brains, and their latest announcement for the Brains pool. Now, I'm using the Brains OS firmware in my mining hardware, and I'm using the Brains pool for my mining. With the Brains OS Plus firmware, I can turn on auto-tuning, where the ASIC chips within my miners are run at their maximum efficiency, making the most of my mining hardware. Now, recently, the Brains pool has made a major upgrade from their previous scoring method to FPPS. And to celebrate the switch to FPPS, Brains is offering a great promotional deal. If you direct your hash rate to the Brains pool anytime before December 31st of 2023, Brains will set the pool fee to a low 2% from now up to the halving event of spring 2024. This applies to miners running any firmware, but you have to act quickly. There's only a few days left to make the switch to get in on this deal. And as always, if you're using the Brains OS firmware along with the Brains pool, Brains will waive the entire pool fee, meaning you only have to pay the 2.5% firmware dev fee on your miner. And with that, on with the episode. Okay, so in past episodes, I've walked through how I've built up my home Bitcoin immersion mining system and how I've integrated my mining into my home infrastructure. My home is now heated by Bitcoin mining, and I preheat my water with the mining heat as well. I've got a link above to my build playlist where you can catch up on all the details of how this came together. Now, in this episode, I'm going to cover a small addition to my system, and that is a heater for my garage. Like a lot of you, my garage is my shop, where I have my tools, my workbench, and a general work area. I don't need this room to be as comfortable as the rest of my house, but it would really be nice if I didn't have to wear a winter coat when working on projects through the winter. Now, my coolant lines for my immersion system already passed through my garage, so it was fairly quick and easy to add a simple, inexpensive heater. But before I get into the design details that went into the build, I'm going to go out into the garage and show you the end results. And so the first thing to show you is my thermostat. And what's really nice about this system is I can just set the temperature and forget it. The system kind of runs automatically from here. I installed this system in the summer where I didn't need the heat, and as we transitioned into the fall, the system would turn on for a few hours every night, and as it got colder and colder, it turned on more and more till now that we're in winter, it's on most all the day. And next spring, this process will reverse itself. As it gets warmer and warmer, the heater will turn off for longer and longer time periods until we get into the summer where the heater will be off for all of the day. And as I've stated before, that's the goal of all of my builds. I want something that I don't have to babysit. I want something that I can simply set and forget and have everything run automatically. Moving on, here in the corner of my garage, you can see the cooling lines exiting my basement, going up the wall and around my garage to my dry cooler. And as you can see, I'm tapping off of them to get some hot cooling fluid to my heater. Now, as you can see, I installed my heater high up on my wall. To be honest, it would have been much better to install that lower so the heat would rise and fill the garage, but I've got other things down below here, and this was just the available space I had. Okay, so up here on the ladder, you can see that this heater is fairly simple. It's a radiator with a fan attached to it. Going into the radiator, I have a zone valve, and this will turn on and off the fluid going through the radiator. Up top, I have an air vent to let out any air bubbles, and I have a small temperature and pressure gauge to help me make sure that the system is pressurized. Exiting the system, I have a thermostatic balancing valve, and I'll cover that in a little bit, but that's how I'll control how much fluid is flowing through the radiator when it is operating. Now, my thermostat, fan, and zone valve are all connected together in the control box. Now, I'll cover the design in a little bit, but the way this works is that when the thermostat senses I need heat, it'll turn everything on, and when it's too hot, the thermostat will shut everything off. And so taking this all together, what I've built here is a garage heater that's quiet and controls itself, in that all I have to do is set a temperature, and it'll turn itself on or off when heat is needed. Okay, so the first part of the design to cover is the plumbing. Here's a basic diagram of the fluid flow, and the main component is a 16-inch square water-to-air heat exchanger. It has three rows of copper tubing, which will really help transfer heat into the air flowing through the radiator. To add this heater to my existing setup, I'm tapping off the main cooling loop for the miners. This means the piping distance and flow resistance through the garage heater is much less than the distance and flow resistance through the rest of the cooling loop. And this means if I don't add any valving or flow control devices to the heater, most of the fluid flow will go through the garage heater, which won't work. My garage heater is much smaller than my dry cooler, and it doesn't have enough cooling capacity to fully cool my mining setup. So to prevent that from happening, I put a thermostatic balancing valve in the output line coming from the heater. I've mentioned these valves in previous episodes, and they can be a key component in immersion mining heating systems. The way these valves work is there is a small wax block within the valve that is attached to internal valve components. The wax expands and contracts based on the temperature of the fluid passing through the valve, and this in turn opens and closes the valve. Taking all of this together, if the fluid passing through the valve cools down, the valve opens, and if the fluid heats up, the valve closes. So all I need to do is to set the desired exit temperature from the heater, say 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and the valve automatically modulates the fluid flow to maintain that temperature. Now there is one downside of thermostatic balancing valves, and that is they don't completely close. They always let a little fluid through the valve. And so I need a second valve to completely shut off the fluid flow when I don't want any heat in my garage in the summer. And here's where zone valves come in handy. There are a lot of different types and models of zone valves on the market, and the design I chose for my garage heater is a 24-volt AC-powered valve with an embedded switch that will activate when the valve is opened. This is going to help with my control circuit design, which I'll cover in a minute. The last couple components on the plumbing side of the design is a vent valve and a temperature and pressure gauge. The vent valve is needed since this heater is a high point on the system and air bubbles will accumulate here. This is a simple float type vent valve, which means it will let out air, but it will keep the rest of the system pressurized. The temperature and pressure gauge is not essential, but it was a great help to make sure I had the correct pressurization when the system was filled. Now, before getting into the control system for the heater, I just want to ask you to hit that like button below, and if you haven't already, hit that subscribe button. This will really help grow the channel and get this information out to more people like you. So here is the circuit diagram for the heater control, and it really isn't too complicated. The main component here is the automotive fan that pulls air through the radiator and blows warm air into my garage. This is the same type of fan I'm using on my dry cooler. I've got a link above to a video covering my dry cooler design to see how all that worked out. And just like in that design, I'm running the fan at less than the normal 12 volts it was designed for, since the fan runs much quieter when running slower. And so the circuit starts with a 12 volt DC power supply. To knock this voltage down, I have a fan power regulator, which lets me dial in the fan speed to the correct sound level I want. The fan circuit is turned on and off using the electrical switch embedded in the zone valve. When the valve is open, the fan gets turned on, and when the valve is closed, the fan gets turned off. And this brings up the other half of the circuit. Zone valves operate on 24 volt AC power, so I need a second circuit to open and close the valve. This part of the circuit is really simple. It's just a 24 volt AC doorbell power supply, the thermostat, and the valve. The thermostat is a baseboard heater thermostat made to turn on and off heating components just like this heater. They are super cheap and really simple to install. It's just an input and output wire to connect. And so taking all of this together, the way this heater works is the thermostat measures the temperature in the room. When it gets too cold, the thermostat closes the 24 volt AC circuit, which opens the zone valve. Once the valve is open, the embedded valve switch closes the 24 volt DC circuit, which turns on the fan. Fluid starts flowing through the radiator piping, and as the radiator cools the fluid, the thermostatic balancing valve will open, allowing more fluid to pass through the radiator. The thermostatic valve will then continue to automatically modulate the fluid flow if more or less heat is needed. And when the room temperature gets warm enough, the thermostat opens the 24-volt AC circuit and shuts everything down, including shutting off the fluid flow. As I noted before, this whole system is completely automatic. I just set the room temperature, and the thermostat and heater design takes care of everything else. Now, although I'm using this heater for my garage, this design is very similar to what is needed to add mining heat to a forced air furnace. I covered adding mining heat in a previous episode, and this heater is just a slight variation of that design. Instead of a freestanding radiator, the radiator is inserted into the output plenum of the furnace. And instead of using an automotive fan to pull air through the radiator, the furnace fan blows air through the radiator. But fluid flow, the zone valve, and the thermostatic valve are all the same in both cases. And the thermostat and wiring is a lot simpler in most home heating cases, and I've covered that topic in a previous episode as well. So hopefully this episode gives you more ideas on how to integrate Bitcoin immersion mining heat into your house reusing that mining heat. Okay, so that's all I've got for this episode. In the next episode, I'm going to cover important hardware you really need to have to be a successful home Bitcoin immersion miner. Like, subscribe so you don't miss any new episodes coming your way. And with that, bye.